everyone. I'm Christos Tsitsaros. I'm a professor of piano pedagogy at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and I'm here today with you to share some ideas from my own teaching practice, some of which came from my experience with remote teaching over the last few months. One of the things I first noticed in my students when I started teaching in this way back in April of 2020 was a sense of emotional distancing, or what I call emotional numbness. I felt that students were trying hard to look like they were interested and willing to do the work I required from them, but I could tell that they were only going through the motions without genuine inner motivation, joy, or enthusiasm. In my mind, there is no doubt that the physical separation that comes with teaching and interacting remotely is often combined with an emotional distancing that over time can result in the student's inability to find enough joy and interest in what they are doing. Even though students can see their teacher and fellow students on the laptop screen, not having them physically around them makes them less inclined to want to communicate something personal. It's like talking to a mirror or to an entity that doesn't really exist, or it only exists in space. Being a communicative teacher right from the very beginning, I felt strongly the need to find ways to change this. Two questions came instinctively to mind. How do I make students who are numb internally, sad and often depressed, feel things in the music to the point that they start wanting to communicate? How do I motivate students who do not have the opportunity to play physically for others or participate in events and share their talent? How do I make them want to practice and progress in a world where such opportunities are on hold and less available? Suddenly, I had to become inventive and come up with ideas that prior to the pandemic, I never thought of because there was no need for them, or at least I never thought that there was one, because I took the psychological availability of students for granted. Although I habitually pay attention to my students' circumstances and needs, in teaching remotely, I felt that I had to go the extra mile to understand my students deeply and approach them on an individual basis, and to adapt my teaching style and demands to their needs rather than the other way around, them adapting their daily habits and practicing routines according to my demands. No longer did I think of them as students in general. Each one of them had now a complete psychological profile in my mental drawer, one that I was studying and observing each time we met. This profile helped me to approach them according to their personality, learning style, personal circumstances, and the way they viewed learning the piano in relation to their other interests, personal goals, and academic background. Also, very importantly, I felt the need to know more about them as people and how the virus situation was affecting them, especially their mood. This personalized understanding of each student proved to be an essential tool in my effort to break through the invisible, impersonal Zoom barrier. Being quite isolated myself during all this time, becoming an ally and a friend to my students helped me to better cope with my own physical and emotional isolation. My lessons actually became my socializing time as well. In fact, the only opportunity to interact with the outside world. This happened quite naturally, but more and more I found myself lowering the professor's guard and letting my true self show instead, the way I am, without pretension, often talking and laughing about personal habits, the way my hair looked, or the way I felt about not being able to do the things I usually love doing. I discreetly asked students about their own lives, whereabouts, food tastes, whether they saw their friends in dorms, attended rehearsals, whether they got tested, how they felt on such and such day, etc. It was interesting to see how witnesses were eager and thrilled to chat with me casually, and how therapeutic these little chats were to both them and me. Like a little ritual, we all looked forward to each time we met on Zoom, following which everyone felt refreshed and mentally available. I was particularly pleased to also notice that following those brief informal interactions, students were far more willing to work with me and more concentrated and respectful as well. The session would start on a positive and upbeat note. This emotional awakening had to also happen in the music we are studying. One of the pitfalls of teaching remotely is the tendency to fall back on emotional engagement and artistic commitment. Students in Zoom sessions tend to play in a rather neutral way, in line with their emotional distancing. To my mind, at least, the reason for this is clear. There is less incentive for true communication. The presence of a real audience, be it one or more people, is not there. It is only constructed virtually. This lack of direct contact leads people to also close down internally and become content with an impersonal way of playing and approaching learning in general. How do we get from a performance that exhibits all the traits of a virtual emotional passivity or distancing to a state of emotional awakening and personal engagement? It's a question that I pose myself many times since I started teaching remotely. As with life, we cannot tell someone to feel a certain emotion. Since emotions are not on demand, I felt that I had to strategize different means to make people feel, or better, make students discover the emotion in the music, or otherwise identify their own emotions in the music they are playing. While in face-to-face sessions, I contented myself in saying, such and such phrase expresses this. Now I thought it necessary to follow a different route in order to instigate the emotion on behalf of the student, rather than me saying, trying to instill in the student's minds a certain emotion that essentially was mine. I tried to let the students understand first what is in the music that make the elements that is the music is made for, and how these elements are conducive to a certain emotion. Questions like, what makes this phrase feel this way? Or how does such and such harmonic, melodic, or rhythmic element add a certain feel or flavor to the music? Such questions became the staple of my recent mode of teaching. The more I made students discover, understand, appreciate these elements, the more I could awaken them the kinds of things I wished for them to feel. More importantly, by doing that, I could be sure that those emotions originated from the students' own understanding of the music and the link between that and what they felt. I call this type of work on musical content and emotional engagement. It is work that for me is absolutely essential from the very beginning stage of learning a piece. Once a student gets used to playing a piece in general, or if you want, an emotional fashion, it is more difficult to add emotional content later because they already have settled in certain ways of playing that exclude the attention to details of interpretation that make all the difference and lead to a meaningful and expressive playing. Emotions are not added later. They have to be felt as soon as one learns a new piece. Everything I do during the lesson, including technical work, has to do with this permeating philosophical idea. Chopin's Mazurka Opus 30, number 2, is an excellent piece and a prime example of the importance of this kind of work. In the first section, it's important to feel each phrase separately, individually, before moving to the other. The emotional content in each phrase is distinct and clearly contrasting from one, two bar phrase to the next one. First phrase, for example, starts from a half cadence with a falling dominant ninth. A more robust minor five to a more, perhaps more optimistic 6 degree. To a bold 2-5-1 cadence. 2-5-1 cadence. Notice the dynamic change in each consecutive phrase and the different axes the composer is using. Piano forte, piano forte. The tendency of the student is to go from one phrase to the next without enough time to assimilate thoroughly and feel the character, as if he was counting and moving through the phrases without enough psychological space. Play like this. Tendency of not creating enough psychological space. Of course, and the fact that it goes from piano to forte makes even things worse, because as you may have noticed in the video, my student, rushes to go to the forte phrase. To the next because it's forte. The next variation of the same phrase presents a new rhythmic element, the dotted rhythms, and also a grace note preceding each phrase. Something we might want to discuss with the student is the way these changes affect the character. Here perhaps is more capricious. To more assertive. Once the student starts to understand the harmonic shifts, rhythmic and agogic elements, we start qualifying the emotions in each phrase using adjectives like vulnerable, pleading, and moving to assertive and decisive. I'm trying to really feel deeply and separately. In doing something, in working on those, and feeling those changes, sometimes I use exaggeration of time. So, example, at the end of the phrase, I have the student stay there and feel more. Feel that seeping, and then here. Stay and feel what's coming next. Or rather, feel what's before moving to what's coming next. In the next ascending phrase, my students showed an instinctive understanding of the character, but in a rather raw way, an exaggerated amount of rubato and loss of crescendo. He's a talented student with excellent musical intentions. However, at 11, neither his prior training nor his musical understanding at the present allow him to penetrate more acutely into the intrinsic